Yeah, I got in trouble this morning. I got rebuked. Like I was an anti-Valentine's. You ever see get hearts on?
Thank you. Good evening. Please take your hymnals and turn to page 13. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Page 13. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 13.
What is the deal? How many of you had a nap today? How many of you slept last night? How many of you are planning to sleep tonight? Oh, you're so mean.
I'm looking for one that says you're so mean. I don't have it. I do have this one, though. I don't mean it, though. Because you're mean to me.
Check your cell phone, please. No, don't check it.
Bernadette, make sure yours is on. She gives turtles.
They're better.
She gives candy. They're better, yeah. I'm into that, so I'm praying hers is on, and it's Valentine's Day. 14th. Did you hear that, man? How many of you already got your wife something? Why are you raising your... Johnny, did you see that? Johnny, I said, how many of you got your wife something? And your wife raised her hand. Works for me. How many of you feel that you just being your wife's husband is enough? Did you hear some of these ladies laugh at us like we don't mean it? Pray for Ron. Do we need to pray for Ron? Ron is very sick. Is it a reaction to the tooth still?
No.
Something else. The other crud. Is it his kids? Maybe. Pray for Ron. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you to help us hear tonight. Help us respond. Help us not to think, boy, that's good for somebody else. Help us to take it personally. And Lord, thank you that you guide us. Thank you for the songs we sing that have meaning, that are powerful. We pray tonight for Ron and his healing and others who are struggling. I think of Larry McFarlane and the difficulty he's having, swallowing, maybe cancer, maybe not. We just pray for healing in his life. We're glad, Lord, that you love us and that you The Bible says, as for God, his way is perfect. And so we trust that. And we need you working us tonight. I'm asking this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
Page 14 in your hymnals, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. 14.
Wow. Ushers, will you come as they come? My wife wants you to know that if you're a secret sister or a prayer sister, they're going to meet up front tonight after the service on the organ side, and they'll draw names for the new prayer sister, secret sisters. If you can't stay, we'll draw for you, this note says, and let you know who you get. Yeah, I know. Man, I want bags of goodies. Yeah, you gonna draw? Let's stay. Let's protest. Not funny. We want stuff. Oh. Let's see. Wednesday, Lord willing. We need to say that more, don't we? We just act like we're in control. We're not. Boast not thyself of tomorrow. So, Lord willing, this week, Wednesday, Tuesday, Valentine's Day, take your wife somewhere special. If my wife could go anywhere, if I said, where do you want to go? She would say McDonald's. Right? Or something cheap. She's not a highfalutin snoot. I am. I want to take her out, you know, and she's like, no. She just wants, the other place she likes to go is like cursing in church, so I'm not even going to say it. Long John Sewer. Silver. Man. If on the 17th you are interested in this Palentine's dinner, that is 630 Culver's, Michigan Street. There's a sign-up list. If you are single and would like to go, we're going to try that. I don't know. I might show up to that, too. Want to show up? If you go, I'll go. But our wives don't get to go. You and me.
They can go together.
Or that. Yeah, but a different Culver's. Mother-daughter banquet on the 12th. That's coming. If you'd like to host an afterglow, there's a sign-up list on the bulletin board. Fred, are you up to praying? Would you?
Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the day that you've given us. Open up our hearts, open up our minds so we can hear your word and so we can live by it. Thank you for the offering and the people that give. And Lord, help us to use it for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Choir. Page 16 in your hymnals, My Faith Looks Up. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 16. Sam is coming to play on the trumpet. Thank you.
like it, but it's a great song. Right? Don't pretend that you always do so well. Trust and obey. The obeying part, I'll do whatever the Lord wants, but boy, sometimes I just struggle to trust Him. Amen? Amen? Second Peter. Second Peter, chapter 1. Second Peter, chapter 1. I call this faith like Peter. And you know what? He didn't have much faith, did he? Walked on the water. You ever walked on the water? Don't be blowing off about how, yeah, but he's saying. Yeah, but did you ever take one step on water? Then hush. Don't you badmouth Pete. He tried. God used him in a great way. Did you ever deny the Lord? Three times? No, he did. You never denied the Lord like he did. God used him. What a great God we have. Faith like Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1. These are verses you have to read real slow because they go down hard. You got to chew it up real good. Like steak, do you ever eat too fast and choke? You got to chew it up. 2 Peter chapter 1. Faith like Peter. Verse 1. You there? Verse 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. Verse 1. Simon Peter. I would have put God's favorite. What did he put? A servant. Was he an apostle? Why didn't he put that? Because Peter has grown a lot. In spite of his failures, in spite of his lack of faith, I think that's what it's all about. I don't like it, but I think that, right? Being a servant. Serving. So he introduces himself. He introduced himself when he wrote the first epistle, 1 Peter chapter 1. He said, Peter, an apostle. So from 1 Peter to 2 Peter, he's grown a lot. He could have addressed himself again as an apostle, as a disciple, as that Peter. You know, the one at Pentecost. What's he call himself? 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Look at it. A servant. And an apostle. Servant first. This world needs servants. Where Jesus said, I came not to be ministered unto, say it, but to minister. Boy, nobody wants to do that, right? Let somebody else do it. I'm not going to serve. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith. And what that means is the same, he's meaning just like I have. In other words, God loved him as much as he loves us. Our faith that we put in Christ makes us equal. We may be used in different ways, not on an equal basis, but he says to them that have obtained like precious faith. With us, through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse 2, grace and peace. God's favor, grace, peace, God's rest. Aren't you glad God was good to you? And He will be. And he gives you his peace, you can rest. Great peace have they, the psalmist said, which love thy law. Nothing shall offend them. Great peace have they. Peter writes and says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Go back to verse 1 a minute. He said, I'm a servant and an apostle, servant first to them that have the same faith through with us, through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Verse 2, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God. It isn't through us, it's through Him. And the way you and I become what we ought to be spiritually, I want to be what the Lord wants me to be spiritually, is through Him. Notice verse 1. Through His righteousness. I'm born into His family because He gave up His righteousness, took my sin so that I could have His righteousness. So God looks at me, not just like He looks at Peter. God won't see me and go, you know, you look just like Peter. He's going to say, you look just like my son. And that's the truth of the matter. Verse 2 says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God. So as you get His righteousness, now you gain knowledge of Him. And with that, you get God's favor and God's peace. Who doesn't want that? I mean, everything else we tried doesn't work. Verse 3. It gets better. I mean, you think going through those two verses, seeing that, it couldn't get better. It gets better. Look at verse 3. According as His divine power. Is God powerful? Did you ever think you were powerful? Huh? Do you ever think you were cool? And then you tripped and fell. One of the first dates Amy and I had. I can tell you, if you don't know this, she's nuts. She does death-defying things. She wants to jump out of an airplane. I said, no. With a parachute. Let me clarify. So when we first met, I said, what do you want to do? She said, I'd like to go to the 4-H fair and ride the rides. I'm thinking bumper cars, merry-go-round. She's got Z's in her eyes. Zipper. You've seen the zipper. Hey? Hey? Death. Death up high. So I'm cool. I got my bib overalls on, tennis shoes. She said, I'd really like to go in the zipper. I don't know how I didn't cry. Because I'm watching it, so the whole thing, right, a belt of moving death trap cages are moving around this, and then that whole death-defying, you've seen the guys that put those up. These are not certified, trained, I mean, they call them carnies. Last time I checked, that means flesh. So I'm watching the zipper go around, and now the whole thing starts going. And then the cages go. I'm tough. Would you take me on that? Sure, it's a date. You know, I'll get to be close to her. Maybe sneak in a kiss. Sorry, I'm just telling you. Are you kidding? I'm holding on for my life. I'm telling myself, don't throw up. Don't cry. You know what she starts doing? Rocking that cage. Come on, we got to get it all the way around. I wasn't a Christian, so I couldn't say, I'm sure this is not God's will. I mean,
That was a long time ago, 1975. And I still have nightmares about it. I wake up like this, and I think it's just her tossing and turning, and I'm thinking she's trying to spin that cage all the way around. I mean, we've been married 45 years. Now I can say, stop it. But then she's just rocking that thing, doing everything she can, and I'm just holding on. And she, come on, come on. No, 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 no. According. God gives us power to get through the things that he knows we're going to go through. Not our power. Everybody else gets off those rides dizzy, not her. Let's go again. Her dad was the same way. We went off, that thing goes up, and that goes over and drops. I said, I'm not going to go. Her dad said, come on. All right. You ever been on that? Go up? Go out? The ride up wasn't bad. I mean, you're sitting in this box, and then the ride out wasn't bad. And then it stops. I thought, okay, great, it's broke. And then it just drops. I'm just doing everything I can. I got to go to the bathroom. I don't want to cry. My hair's probably messed up. Amy and her dad jump off and go, let's go again. I go, no. Verse 3, according as his divine power had given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, here's the word, through again. Through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. We're going to read verse 4 and stop there. Whereby? Whereby are given unto us. See, Peter said, God likes me like he likes you. Same faith, same God, same power, same working. He said, the promises to me are to you. Look, when God wrote this, he knew it was going to be written to us. He didn't write to a select few at that time. I mean, that's what I believe about the Bible. If you're going to discount, well, Peter meant that. You know what? It's meant for us now. Whereby, verse 4 says, are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. Let me explain that a minute before I finish that verse. When you got saved, you received God's nature. But as you partake of it, you become more glued to him. Joined. The joinery, the partaking there is the word for as near as can be. When you come together, it isn't just, yeah, we're together. Now what? No, it keeps getting better and bigger and greater and more powerful. He said, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Heavenly Father, I'm hoping that I'll hear what you want to say tonight, because I know I need it. I also know that someone else might need it. And as much as I want to preach to all of us, I have to see this as, what do you want to do in me? What do you want to say to me? And I hope all of us will take that approach. God, as your word is preached tonight, say it to me. Help me hear it. Help me to grab it. Help me to act on it. And Lord, I don't want it just to be preaching. I want it to be, how can it make my Christian life more exciting? I want my Christian life, Lord, to be lived in the experience and the divine power as you've given me a divine nature. I want all that to come through for me and out of me and through me into this world so that others can be challenged and hungry for that. And Lord, I'm hungry for that tonight. I'm hungry to have a faith like Peter had. Thank you, God. Help us tonight. Oh, help us. Help us to see we need it. Help us to see you're talking to us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I like in this chapter, Peter says, we have not, jump down, verse 16, chapter 1, 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 16. He said, we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. You know, I think Peter is saying that if he had God's power in his life, now think about this. If you had God's power in your life, think of how many things you wouldn't do that you shouldn't do. If you had God's power in your life, think about how many things in your life you would do that you should do. Peter's thinking about his denial. Boy, I wish I would have never done that. Wish I had his power. Remember Jesus told them, hey, want to tell you, praying for you. What'd Peter say? I'm good. Don't need it. Pray for Judas. He's bad. Well, they didn't know that. He said, we've not followed something that someone else came up with. He said, we saw him. We're eyewitnesses, verse 16. We're eyewitnesses of his majesty. Can you imagine? I mean, we're going to see him. But Peter saw him. Peter didn't just serve him and listen to him and watch him do great miracles. Peter watched him glow like he looks probably in heaven. He goes on, verse 17. It says, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory. Can you imagine that? Paul heard it. Peter said, we were there. Wow! He was just as bright, the transfiguration, as bright as could be. Then all of a sudden, God speaks from heaven. Won't it be just, I don't know a word, won't it be something when we get to heaven and we can hear God speak? I know God loves me. But when I get to heaven and he says these words to me, I hope. Well done. Well, are you bragging? No, I'm just telling you. I want to live so that he says well done. Say, well, you think he's going to say it? Probably not, but I'm trying. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Peter said, that voice from the excellent glory said, verse 17, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Wow. I get the chills reading that. How do you hear that? How could you ever be the same? Wouldn't you tell everybody that? Hey, how you doing? I'm good. Can I tell you something? Yeah, I was on the mount. Jesus lit up. God spoke from heaven. Did he now? Yeah, really? No, I heard him. Wouldn't you love to share that story? Verse 18, this voice which came from heaven, he says it again, we heard. This voice we heard. when we were with him in the Holy Mount. Verse 19. Then he says this. We have also. You have a pen? You ought to underline more sure. You get what Peter's saying? He tells us twice he heard his voice. He said, we have something better. What could be better? Hey, what could be better than seeing Jesus light up and hearing God's voice? Verse 19, we also have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star rise in your hearts. Verse 20, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. Verse 21, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Get what Peter's saying? Peter said, I'd rather have a Bible than hear God's voice. I can't say that. I mean, if you ask me, I'd rather hear his voice. Peter said, no, I've heard it. This is more sure. And it is, isn't it? Wife ever tell you something? You forgot? She didn't. Hey, if your wife tells you something, she's not going to forget. Raise your right hand. It's true. Peter said, this is more sure. Say, what's he talking about? He's talking about you and me having the Bible. Not talking about a bunch of people sitting around unrolling scrolls. I mean, he's talking about them too, but he's talking to us. That we, what we have is all we need. These are the very, look, you and I need to nail that down. These are the very words of God. Peter said, verse 16, we haven't followed some fable. We need to treat these words like they came from God and that they're better than any other, listen, better than any other person's advice or thoughts.
What do you think I should do?
Don't ask that. Grab a Bible. How come we're not going to the Bible?
Well, I just want to know what they think.
They probably think wrong. Even if they're reading the Bible, if it comes out of their mouth to you, it could come out wrong. Try that. What do they used to call it? Telephone? Say something to one person, 10 people later, it's like wild. You heard the story, Amy's brother came to through town with a U-Haul. Paul, I was just here a year. Parked in the lot. People were calling me. Several people called and said, good, we knew you'd move. Good, we knew you wouldn't last. I'm like, well, what do they know I don't know? Well, we go, oh, they saw the U-Haul. They think we're moving. 34 years ago. They're still calling. Haven't seen any U-Hauls lately. Hoping you'd move. I'm gonna someday. Right to heaven. Peter said, God knows. Go back to the beginning of the chapter. Verse 2. You want grace? You want peace? It's knowing God. How do you know God? Through his word. You don't know him by meditating. You don't know him by reading other books. Other books are great. Well, you and I have to just consume this book. You understand that? There's nothing else. Peter said, I was on the mountain and I saw Jesus light up and I heard the voice of God, but I'd rather have the Bible. You say, it doesn't mean that. Yeah, it exactly means that. God's not going to let us get in the way of his power and what he can do in us. So he gave us a Bible and said, look, read this. Here it is. I put it all in there. You imagine if we had to do everything by what someone tells us and we had to remember it? I'll meet people and they'll go, remember me? Like, nope. I don't. I mean, I'm old. I'm dumb. I got to the funeral home yesterday. The guy greeted me. He was a worker there. He had a name tag on it. It said, Jim Smart. He said, what's your name? I said, Vito Dumb. He said, really? I said, is your name really Jim Smart? He said, well, yes. I said, okay, me too. Look, all I know is that God has told me what he wants me to know. He told Peter, you say, yeah, but Peter, I know. So Peter says, hey, you need to be a servant. You've got precious faith. Verse 1, we've obtained that same faith, same power that Peter had. Peter gets up, read the book of Acts. Peter gets up in the book of Acts and preaches, and man, thousands of people come to Christ. Peter knew that wasn't him, that was God. Do you really believe that you could have the faith that Peter had? I want you to believe that. I want you to believe that you can live a life like Peter. A servant, powerful faith. So we have to put aside what we feel or what we think, and we have to trust what God said. I'm glad that Jesus took all my sin on the cross. Verse 1, and I took all his righteousness. Man, I don't know how God does that or did that, but he did it. God took all my sin. Everything I would commit. And said, I'm going to trade you. If you come to the cross, if you believe that I can pay, wash away your sin, I will give you my righteousness. Amen. I mean, I didn't know that when I got saved, but that's what I did. I just knew I needed to get to heaven. I knew I needed a Savior. I knew I couldn't get there. Now watch verse 1. We've obtained like precious faith to them, he says, all of us, that's through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. You think God does things half-hearted? You think God says, well, I know them, and they're going to make me look bad if I give them the whole bundle. No. When you got righteousness, you got all you needed. Now listen very carefully. You can't get any more righteous than that. Three things. Number one. It's about knowing God. Not knowing church, not knowing verses, not knowing how to read the Bible, not knowing how to witness, knowing God. The grace and peace, verse 2, the grace and peace that come, not just come, but come multiply. Boy, I could use, and that means a lot. I could use a bunch of that, could you? Say, yeah, I'm going to work tomorrow. I'm really going to need that. There it is. And he said, how do you get it? Through the knowledge of God, through knowing God. I think they ought to see it on our face. I don't think it should be something that we try to convince them with. I think that they ought to just know it. You know, I was reading, man, what a verse. Matthew 5:41. If someone wants you to go a mile, go two. Who lives like that? I mean, think about the workforce now. How much do I have to do? That's crept into Christianity. Do I have to be at every service? No, you get to be. Come on. Come on. This isn't about, this is about God. I mean, you get to heaven and God goes, I've changed my mind about you. You're such a loser. I mean, God's not going to say that because he can't change. But isn't it sometimes we're just doing enough to get by? Watch me. And then we're miserable and we wonder why? Hey, go a mile? That's rough. I'm told, that kind of threw me, so I looked it up. Of course, the Jews were living under Roman persecution and Roman dominance. The Roman government was in charge. And they said, because you're a Jew, if you see a Roman carrying any kind of load, you had to grab it and take it a mile. I don't know if this is true, but it makes sense. You know the mile markers on the highway? They tell me that's where that came from. Because if you're going to go a mile, it's a mile and no more. Right? In school, 500-word paper, 501. Right? So it said that they marked off a mile, so if they did carry that load, they'd go a mile, drop it off, turn around, go back home. Jesus said, that's nice. You ought to go too. Imagine if we lived that way, what the world would say about us. So they see us doing just enough to get by. I'm sorry this sounds like preaching. It's just been one of those days. Huh? You mean, what do you mean? What? Why? Why? Is it time to go yet? Is it time to go yet? That's why our Christianity, excuse my language, that's why our Christianity stinks. Because we do just enough. God talks about grace and peace. He doesn't just talk about enough. He talks about multiplied. As we know God, according, I think, to verse 2, as we know him through the knowledge, I think that grace and peace comes. Say, well, it's not here yet. Well, make it come. I think the greatest thing you or I could have on the earth is a knowledge of God and be close to him. So we have to believe that knowing God will lead to being full of grace and peace. If we believe that, if we believe that we need that, then we'll spend more time getting to know him. This is going to get ugly. Settle in. Settle in your seat because I don't want you falling off of it. Calculate the time you spend on other stuff besides getting to know God. Let me help. Thanks for asking. I'd love to help. Television. Compare the time you spend in front of the TV to the time you spend getting to know God. Well, Pastor, the TV just relaxes me. It does. I want to shoot it. I mean, nutso. It's nutso. Relax. What do you think peace means in verse 2? You think God would promise, hey, get to know me, I'll give you peace. I don't really know that. Just trying to get you to know the Bible. God isn't tricking us. How much time do you spend on the internet? The funeral home called me this week. I missed the call about Susie Beeman. I got back to my phone. I said, I'm sorry I missed your call. She said, that's fine. I said, I don't carry my phone around like a teenager. And she laughed. I said, that's true, isn't it? She said, yeah, you're right. I said, I don't do that. I'm not that important that I need to have it in my hand every second of the day. And number two, I hate it. I don't hate you. I hate the phone. I hate that it's got such a grip on us. I hate that people used to go out and talk and laugh. Now all you can hear is tick, tick, tick. Right? Add up how much time you spend on your phone or the internet or your computer compared to the time you spend getting to know God. Yeah, I'd be quiet too. Facebook, social media. Say, there he goes again, picking on that. I told you to settle in. I don't want you to fall off your seat. Yeah, but all my friends, don't you need God more than you need a friend? I mean, that stuff just captures us. Say, get off of it already. All right, what about the time you spent on your lawn? Oh, we should have nice lawns. I never said that. I never said you shouldn't. I just said you should spend more time getting to know God. What about the time spent in your garden? Gardens are healthy. Will you quit defending yourself? I'm talking about spending time with God. Nothing. You say, there's nothing wrong with a garden. If it takes up more time than you spend with God, it's an idol. You might as well bow down to it. What about your hobbies? Oh, I knew you were going there. Hey, we're just getting there. So hobbies are good. I didn't say they weren't. But boy, we spend a lot of time and money on them, don't we? I'm talking about compared to getting to know God. You want grace and peace? Know God. Yeah, but this, when I do this, it just makes me feel, I don't know what golfing does for you. I want to kill myself. Well, I handle it different. Hey, look, you know what? My wife says, you spend so much time reading, and I'm going to die right. I mean, if I crack up or what, I'm. You say, you need a hobby. Who's got time for a hobby? Say, boy, you're making me mad. I'm trying. I'm not done yet. We work overtime. Get another job. First stuff. We're tired. We're not knowing God. Hey, we're so busy with stuff. Say, you sure are picking on us tonight. Yeah, because I just think knowing God is more important than anything else in your life. Hey, if you wanna fire me or whatever you do for that, go ahead. Because that's the way it is. You and I should know God. Nothing should get in the way of that. Not a job, not a spouse, not kids, not grandkids. Too often it's about what we want. We're supposed to know God. An idol is anything that keeps us from time with the Lord. If we're not worshiping Him the most, then whatever we're spending time on is what we're worshiping. And you're arguing, isn't it bad? It's bad if it takes you away from God. Man, our country needs God. Our neighbors need God. Our family needs God. And we're spending useless time on stuff that won't count. Peter's saying, look, the more you know God, the more peace you'll have, the more grace you'll experience. That's what I want. I want to know God. Number two, I want divine power. I want divine power. Verse 3, he says, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. He doesn't just say godliness, he says life and godliness. Isn't that good? Power for life and godliness. Not just power for godliness. Power for life and God. Look at verse 3. Through the knowledge of him that called us to glory and virtue. Didn't he just say that in verse 2? Yeah, it must be important. When God repeats himself, it's important. If we're living a godly life, why is it? It isn't because we're a good person. It isn't because we're a great person. It's because his divine power is given to us. And God, in that verse through Peter, is saying, I've given you everything you need to live a godly life. The power to make that happen. Man, it works. It works. It's not preaching. It's not a Bible. It's not just some fable. It works. If we aren't godly, if we're not living that godly life, whose fault is it? 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Don't forget the last three words, that love him. You love him? Oh, yeah. Hey, make that list of the time you spend with him. It'll blow your mind. It'll make you want to quit. You won't believe you've been so ungodly. I've done it. Man, you get on something, you can't get off. Reading this, reading that, clickety-click, clickety-click. Hey, remember when you used to have to go to the library and pull books out, open them, shuffle through pages? You don't do that anymore. Tick, 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 clickety-click. There it is. Print it. We're so lazy. When we first came here, we had old stuff. Washer and dryer was old. Band-Aids, duct tape, wire, bungee cords. Couldn't afford zip ties. Man, stuff would break. I was making $25 a week here. I'd say something to Amy's dad, oh man, the washer's broken. He'd go, fix it. I said, I can't fix it. I mean, I can comb my hair, but that's about the extent of my talents. You know what he said to me? Go to the library, get a book. 1987. Go to the library, get a book. I said, in what? He said, the book will tell you how to fix it. Look at her. I'm pouring through those books. I'm copying stuff. I didn't have videos. Huh? Everything's in a video. Want to make a bomb? We got a video for that. You had to go to the library and get a book on bomb building. I'm pouring through these books. I surprised myself. I would go to him. We'd be eating. I'd go, hey, Mr. T. I called Mr. T. It was trees. I said, I didn't call him Dad, or I called him Dad once in a while. I said, hey, guess what? I rebuilt this part on the fridge. He said, yeah, I knew you could. You did? Yeah, it's in a book. Just follow what the book says. Is that what you did? Yeah. Okay. He wasn't very impressed. He said, when you do what the book says, that's what happens. Ta-da. Ta-da. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. It isn't enough to know the right things about God. It's about knowing Him. Not about searching other books. It's not about looking up Greek words and Hebrew words. And it's about just getting into this book and going, you wrote this. You can make me know this. I'm going to wait on you. Please show me. And He will. That's how you grow as a Christian. Don't let anybody fool you. I hope you come to church because you love God. I hope that you fell in love with Him because He sent His Son to die for you. And I hope you trust Him now because you want Him to lead you through that power that we don't have. Number three, knowing God, divine power, and then He talks in verse 4, number 3, about a divine nature. Divine. Godlike. Husband, if I asked your wife, is your husband godlike, what would she say? She'd lie for you, I get it. But what would she be thinking? Huh? Huh? Wives, if I asked your husband, is your wife godlike? Not act God. Does she act? No, I didn't say that. I said, is she? Nobody knows me better than my wife. We've been together 48 years. Married 45 next month. She knows me. It's scary. I mean, a day's going to come where we're just going to look at each other and go like this. She'll look back and go. I'll look at her and go. She'll look back. We won't even have to talk. I mean, that's what it's coming to. I'll be thinking about something and she'll finish it. I'll go, no. And it isn't because I don't want help. It's just that I hate it. I want to communicate. Verse 4, Peter says, whereby are given unto us. Given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. He could have said promises. And if they're the promises of God, that's enough. Nope. He says exceeding great and precious. Nothing better, precious, nothing more valuable. It seems like so often we get bored with God. Bored with this book. And I'm pretty sure if you're bored with God, it's you. Because I think God's exciting. I think what God can do is so powerful. And I think this divine nature thing, when He's talking there about exceeding great, that means nothing greater. Isn't it amazing how we're always want something more, better, faster, bigger, right? Man, we just had that. And then the new one comes out, we want that one. Christians get bored with God's promises. And I see them get more excited about worldly things. Super Bowl, who cares? I'm so sick of sports. You know, everything is like, you know, white people hate everybody. Who cares? I mean, God, why are we debating things that are like just stupid? I'll tell you why, because Christians have kind of retracted their influence. And so this world is just going bizarre. Right? Think about some of the stuff they're coming up with. They want to be able to counsel a kid to have a surgery to change their sex and not tell their parents. Really? Is that like, wow? It isn't just give them a piece of candy because the mom doesn't want them to have sugar. Give them a piece of candy. Don't tell your mom. They're talking about gender reassignment surgery. But don't tell the parents. Or you don't need the parents' permission. Am I missing something? I'll tell you what I'm missing, heaven. Because this place stinks. I mean, they're nutso. It's just nuts. But I think if Christians would get excited about God, they don't see us excited about God. Excited about church, excited about living for Him, excited about the good news. Man, we get excited about a new job or a new house, something that may not seem to be so wrong. We're not excited about God. Man, I'm excited about God. I don't want to get used to the fact that God lives in me, divine nature. He isn't just living. Listen to me. He isn't just living. He's living in me. And you. Verse 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, that divine nature will take over more. Boy, I need that. He's not next to me. He's inside of me. The perfect union. Partake. It's not like eating a cookie. He's in me. Divine nature. It's a nature now that I didn't have before. When a lost person does bad things, it's because that's all they've got. I mean, their old nature, their fleshly nature can do some good, but man, they'll never get to heaven without a divine nature. And they certainly can't please God. It's like the Spirit of God, and I don't want to sound superior. I don't want to sound kooky. It may be too late. I don't want to sound spooky. But it's like when you allow the Spirit of God to just take over, it's like you live in another world. Because this place is terrible. I mean, it's crazy. And so the Spirit of God takes the Word of God. He says in that verse and helps us escape. See the word? Having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. Man, there's a lot of this world we need to escape. They keep trying to pull us in, draw us in, make us think like them and act like them and talk like them. I'm done. I need you to listen. And I need you to listen so hard that you answer this honestly in your own heart. Is there one thing in your life right now that you don't want anyone else in this room to know about? One thing you'd be ashamed of? One thing you can't get victory over? One thing that you know has got a hold on you? You know what that thing's doing? It's keeping you from knowing God and enjoying God. I have a lot of faults. I fail a lot. But I'm enjoying God. I'm enjoying being a Christian. I'm enjoying serving Him. I don't want to stop. So Peter says, God made sure to give us everything that we need to live a life that's godly. Are you godly? If I went to your boss and said, do you call them godly? I went to your neighbors. Did your neighbors say, if I asked, are they godly? Godlike? What would they say? Why don't we just make sure we are? Why would you not be? Why would you
Get dressed. And you're not in your pajamas. You could be at home in your pajamas watching the Supper Bowl. But you came to church. Why would you not just go all the way and say, I'm just going to be as godly as I can be? Heavenly Father, please tonight speak to us like you're only speaking to us. There's a room full of us. There might be many things in our life that we're ashamed of. There might be addictions, not drug addictions. But there can be other addictions that are bad. Things that just possess us when you ought to possess us. It might be that someone tonight just bored. Just their Christian life is just the same old, and they don't experience you like they should, and they don't know your power, and they don't realize that divine nature that's in them, and they're not taking advantage of it. They're just living a lower life than they need to live. God, may you show us how to experience a knowledge of you that gives us grace and peace like we've never had before. You said grace and peace be multiplied unto you. God, multiply the grace and peace in our lives. May we experience, may we see, may others see divine power. Not our power, not our wit, not our wisdom. God's power. The power of God, heavenly power. Only God could do that. That's what we need, Lord. That's what we want. We want the divine nature to be the nature that rules and steers and guides our life. It did Peter's life. At first, no, but when he wrote this, he was all in. He said, boy, you need to experience this. I see it now. Y'all, this is for all of us. You've got life, precious faith. This needs to be what you enjoy and you experience. And man, is it exciting. Lord, I want that, and I want that for every person in this room, that the Christian life would be exciting. Not a burden, not boring, not gotta do this, gotta do that. Thank you, God, that your nature is in us. Everything we do ought to be special because you're in us. The fact of your presence in our life, the fact that we are joined to you, we are a partaker of that nature, ought to be that everything we do, everywhere we go, everything we touch should be special. Because of the divine nature. God, speak to all of us in this room. You've spoken to me. I didn't want to preach this because I already felt like I had to deal with some of it. And I got to deal with more of it tonight. But Father, you just speak to every man, woman, young person that's hearing this. May their heart say, man, that's exactly what I need to do. It ain't about the preacher. It ain't about the message. It's about what God is saying to us in these moments. Oh, God, may we respond to you. May we quickly just run to do what you want. I mean, run. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. Is there one thing in your life right now that you don't want anybody else in this room to know about? God will give you victory. Something you're not doing, you ought to be doing. If people really knew, it'd bother you. Why don't you let God give you the victory and the power? Preacher, God is speaking to my heart. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. Preacher, God is speaking to my heart. something needs to happen on my part tonight. God has done the speaking. God is. I need to address what He's shown me. That you? That you? Heads bowed, eyes closed. Here's my hand, preacher. Here's my hand. Preacher, here's my hand. I need to go after this. Preacher, I want to put it off. I don't want to see it. Don't want to mess with it. But preacher, I need to do this. I need to confront this. I need to take care of this tonight. 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 Will you? Will you? Dear Father, we give you this time. This is your time that you would supernaturally ring our bell. Get our attention. Nudge us. Prod us. Push us. Drag us. Spirit of God, we need your power. We need your power in our own life, in our own home, wherever we go. This world needs a great big dose of it, and we need you to multiply in us the grace and peace of God. We can't. You can, though. Please do that. Please multiply grace and peace in our life. Please give us that divine power. Please allow our divine nature to rule and reign in our lives. I pray this for Jesus' sake. Really, really. Help us, God, please. In His name I pray. Piano playing. You're standing. If you're coming, you need to move. You'll talk yourself out of it. You know how that goes, right? You know how that goes. I'm not that bad. I could take care of it at my seat. And you're right, you can. You can. But it'll be better if you'd leave your seat. Just come up here and say, oh God, oh please God, everything from your word, everything is preached tonight. I want the Bible to be bigger to me than your own voice. I want the Bible to be so powerful, so sure in my life that if God spoke from heaven, I'm more sure of God because of what He wrote in His word and what I know about Him from His word, that does me more good than His voice from heaven. Come on, come on. Heads bowed, eyes closed, unless you're coming. Give up some of that stuff. Give up some of that time you're spending you don't need to spend. Give that time to God. Man, let's see God do something in our church. Because a bunch of us said, boy, I'm just going to give more time to God. I'm going to invest time in God. I'm going to put less time in front of the TV and less time on the internet or Facebook or some other thing. I'm going to spend less time doing what I want and having fun and whatever it is, good or bad. I just want to set that aside. Just give God some real quality time and just know Him. I just want to know Him. God wants us to know Him. God so desperately, I believe, wants us to know Him. Pray with me. We'll be dismissed, except for the ladies, the secret sisters. I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, it's too easy for me as a Christian, not as a preacher, but as a Christian, just too easy to read the Bible and glad enough that I read it. Too easy for me to pray and just be happy enough that I prayed. I want my time in your word to change me, to cause me to know God like I've never known Him before, You're that big, and I realize every time I meet with you and do that, I can know more of you. I got to love you, though. You said you can do things nobody can even think about, never seen, if I love you, that love him. I have not seen, but we got to love him. I want to love you enough that I spend time in your word, that I crave and plead for your power. Divine power, God-like power. That I would want my divine nature to be visible, obvious, in control. Please do that in my life. That's my prayer for me. Others can pray that. Lord, we want to have faith, big faith, powerful faith, exciting faith. Not just, yeah, I'm a Christian, yeah, I go to church. The world's sick of that. That isn't helping them. They need some power. They need grace and peace in us multiplied. God's goodness. Please work in us. Please. Oh, Lord. Help us. I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Up here, ladies, if you're involved, secret sister, prayer sisters.